In this talk, I have a co-author, that is Dr. V. L. Narayanan, who did his PhD from the Equatorial Geophysical Research Laboratory in southern India in the year 2013 or so. Then he did his postdoctoral work in Japan and came back and joined as an Inspire faculty at the National Atmospheric Research Laboratory in Gadangi in India. He has done very good work using the air glow imaging technique to study some of the mesosphere and thermospheric phenomena and their coupling through waves coming from the lower part of the atmosphere. So therefore he has given a lot of information and inputs for this presentation, and so I have used them liberally. Okay, with these few words of introduction, we pass on to the subject matter. So here we are talking about the coupling. The ionosphere is not a isolated medium with watertight boundaries, but it has interactions and coupling with regions below the ionosphere, that is the neutral atmosphere, and also the regions above that, like the magnetosphere, the solar wind, solar radiation, and so on. So it is because of this interactive process that many interesting phenomena take place in the ionosphere. So coupling from above is mainly guided by the solar wind, which is, I said, just which comes all the way from the sun. It's a kind of plasma flow, and some of the typical parameters of the solar wind are given here, like the electron density, the proton density, a little bit of alpha particles, what is the typical velocity, 450 kilometers per second, the typical temperature of the plasma, typical magnetic field in that is of the order of 10 nano tesla, and this existence of this kind of his plasma flow from the sun was inferred, as shown here, by observation of the cometary tails. You see, this is the head of the comet and this is the tail, and the tail is always extended in a direction which is away from the sun, or which is called the anti-sunward direction. That means the sun is on this side and this is always on the opposite side of the sun, as if some pressure is applied from the sun which is pushing it in this direction. So this pressure is nothing but the pressure of the solar wind. So now this picture shows the solar wind coming from the sun as indicated by this arrow, and this indicates the magnetic field associated with the solar wind, as we said, typically about 10 nano tesla, and its direction can be either upward or downward or southward or northward. So here it is shown that it is downward. So this plasma and magnetic field come and impinge on the Earth's geomagnetic field and interact with the magnetic field, with the result that the magnetic field on the dire side is compressed like this instead of a dipole structure, and the magnetic field on the night side is extended like this. So the normal dipole structure has undergo some distortion like this, and then there is a boundary formed, which is called the boshock, into which the solar wind cannot enter. So it has to get deviated and flow out like this towards the night side, and then further to other planets. It is not only on the Earth. The solar wind comes from the sun and goes all the way up to the end of the solar system and probably even beyond. So because of this interaction, the magnetosphere is formed, which is the cavity into which the Earth's magnetic field is confined. And then the boshock we have shown here, then the magnetopause, this is a boundary between the magnetosheath and the actual magnetopause. And this has an extended tail on the night side, which is called magnetotail. And the magnetic field on this side and this side are in opposite direction. So therefore, somewhere if they come very close to, they will annihilate and form a neutral point. And the green region here is region which is filled with plasma, and therefore it is called a plasma sheet. And also we have some very near earth plasma configuration, which is called the plasma sphere. So all these have some different roles in the interaction with the ionosphere. Now the coupling from above, also coupling from below, from the lower atmosphere, are shown here. It's a complex figure with so many information put into that. The system is called terrestrial atmosphere, atmospheric ITM, that is ionosphere, thermosphere, mesosphere processes. So there are different chains which are producing different effects. One is the solar radiation chain. We know the electromagnetic radiation, like extreme ultraviolet coming from the sun. Then you have the solar wind, which we just now mentioned. So there are two things coming from the sun. And then also very energetic particles are coming from the sun. And these particles, they do not have a straight line path, but because the magnetic field makes them spiral and then reach the near the earth. And because of this motion of the charged particles, some currents are set up, and there is a current flowing inward at the inner or poleward edge of this circle, which is the auroral oval. And then the closed path for the current is provided across the auroral region, and then there is an outward current flowing like this. So these currents also link up very far away outward regions of the of the earth's environment, plasma environment, to the ionosphere. So it's a form of coupling between ionosphere and outer regions. Similarly, there are upwelling and flow. The yellow arrow shows the flow of neutrals. Then there is a interaction between solar wind, magnetosphere chain, which is interacting with ionosphere, and some energy is conveyed or carried or transmitted from magnetosphere to ionosphere. That sets up some sort of a plasma circulation in the polar regions and things like that. Then some of the phenomena that we discussed in the equatorial region, like the equatorial fountain effect shown here. Then the ionospheric trough is shown here. Then there's a the charged particles impinging on the auroral zone, they deposit their energy there, and some currents are flowing there, and these currents produce what is called joule heating. And because of this heating, there's a wind system set up, which is making the flow of neutrals from polar regions to equatorial regions. So there are many things happening due to interaction of the atmosphere ionosphere system with solar wind, solar radiation, solar energetic particles, and so on. Now in the next slide we will see what are the postings from below. For example, there can be a kind of waves called the gravity waves, which are generated due to the flow of the wind across structures like mountains and uneven surfaces on the earth. That will generate a kind of waves called gravity waves. So they can propagate up to this is our ITM region, extending from about 60 kilometers to 500 kilometers. And so it can propagate up to that region and produce some effects in the mesosphere, ionosphere, etc. Then another kind of waves generated in the lower atmosphere are planetary waves. They also couple some energy to there. Then there are tides. We mentioned about that in a previous talk, which are driven by the absorption of the solar radiation. So the water vapor and ozone, they get heated up and they drive the thermal tides. They also propagate and produce some effects here. Then some kind of mass transport also is possible from the minor constituents, carbon dioxide, methane, and so on, from lower height to higher heights. Then there's a convective or thunderstorm activity occurring at lower atmosphere, which also is a source of gravity waves, and they also produce. And some of these waves, when they reach this boundary, their energy is deposited there and they generate turbulence there. So then there is also a coupling from the polar region or high latitude to low latitude through the dynamical phenomena of the circulation patterns, through the electric fields which are generated there and then transmitted to lower latitudes and so on. So this is the an overview of the coupling. So there is a vertical coupling within this ITM system because of the energy transport from lower altitude as well as from higher altitudes. So this vertical coupling is indicated by these vertical arrows. And the main cause of this coupling from below, that is from the lower atmosphere, is the different kinds of wave motions, wave forms set up in the lower atmosphere. They are all in general called atmospheric waves. So one class of waves is the atmospheric gravity waves. So they propagate up to ionospheric heights and then manifest there as traveling ionospheric disturbances or TIDs. They also trigger some ionospheric instabilities like the spread F and ES irregularities that we talked about in a previous lecture. So then there is also another class of waves called tides. This is driven by the solar thermal tides or heating due to absorption of radio radiation from by different constituents like water vapor, ozone, etc. So they also have a probable link to another phenomena called counter electrojet. And there are diurnal tides, semi diurnal tides, and then some wave number four structure. We will show some examples of this. Then another class of waves called planetary waves with longer periods, and then another kind called Kelvin waves, and they have some effect on ionosphere. So these are, now the picture here illustrates a typical wave which is generated in the lower atmosphere, and then it is propagating upward. But as it propagates upward, because the atmospheric neutral density is exponentially decreasing with respect to height, the amplitude of the wave has to increase in order to conserve the kinetic energy density in that. So the therefore the amplitude goes on increasing, but nothing can go on indefinitely. After some stage, a saturation effect comes because some dissipative effects start playing there, like eddy and molecular diffusion or thermal conductivity. So these kind of things dissipate the energy of the wave, and therefore thereafter they start weakening in amplitude. So in this region where maximum amplitude is there, because of non-linear effects, phenomena called wave breaking occurs, and because of presence of convective and shear instabilities there, so they deposit their energy, the wave energy is deposited there, and after that the wave becomes weakened and propagates further. So if these waves propagate up to ionospheric heights under favorable conditions, then they can produce things like TIDs, ionospheric instabilities, and so on. So this is concept. Now, so the gravity waves are a kind of waves or which are driven by the vertical oscillations of the air parcels under the influence of two forces: the driving force, the buoyancy force, which tries to push the parcel of air upward, and then the gravity force tries to bring it back. So under the influence of these two forces, it undergoes a vertical oscillation, and that is called the gravity wave. One should not confuse this with the gravitational wave which astronomers talk about. That is totally different. So because it is affected by the gravitational force which of the earth, which is a restoring force for the oscillations, it is called gravity wave. So one of the properties of the waves, they are transverse in nature, that is the perturbations are in a plane perpendicular to the direction of propagation of the waves. So as we can see here, this is an illustration. This is sort of corrugated earth surface, which is need not be exactly sinusoidal, but with a sort of irregular, with the hills and valleys and mountains and so on. So if when the wave flows over such a surface, then perturbations in the wind parameters like the U dash, the perturbation in zonal wind, perturbation in meridional wind, perturbation in the pressure, in temperature, in density, all these things can be produced. These perturbations are the waves shown by the sinusoidal curves here. So these are the crest and trough for high and low in the waves. So it appears from the slant at an angle. So the direction of propagation is perpendicular to that, as you said, because transverse waves, the wave appears to move in this direction, but at the same time the energy content of the wave is propagating in the upward direction. So energy propagation and wave phase propagation are not in the same direction. This is a property of the gravity wave. And so the downward phase propagation and upward energy propagation is to be illustrated here, but there is an animation which should have shown it more clearly, but in this presentation that is not shown. But what we should note is the color coded temperature. These are the temperature low, increasing, reaching a maximum, and again decreasing. This kind of changes in temperature are occurring in the atmospheric layers. At the same time, these arrows are indicating the winds. So in some part the wind is downward, in some part wind is upward. So the wind also changes in direction upward to downward, so which is leading to fluctuations. So the energy will be propagating in the upward direction and the phase will be propagating in the downward direction. This is a actual measurement of the vertical in the vertical direction as a height function of height. The wind components U and V, that is the meridional and zonal wind components, measured, and their mean value is subtracted, and the fluctuations or deviations from the mean value are shown here, both in U and V. And you see a certain height ranges. If you amplify or magnify that, you will see there are periodic fluctuations. And these periodic fluctuations are due to the kind of gravity waves which are propagating. So here the different colors represent measurement by different techniques like the MU radar, the rocket zones, blue and yellow, and radio zones, light blue and green. So different, all the different techniques show similar wind structures, and the waves in that are discernible here. And this is a two-dimensional picture. This is only vertical in one direction. This is a two-dimensional picture. This is a phenomena called air glow emission. There are some optical emissions from the sun due to some reactions taking place. They are called radiative recombination reactions. So this air glow emission, if it is imaged using a imaging technique, then you will see some wave-like patterns are there, and they are propagating in this direction, which is representing the downward phase propagation. So the air glow is occurring at a mesospheric heights, about 85 km or more. These are occurring at much lower heights, 10, 15, 20 km. So these are propagating up to these heights and producing their effects there. So this is what is shown here. These are similar pictures. These are taken from the paper by Narayan and Gurubaran. The Narayan, who is the co-author in this, published in 2013. So this is a clear manifestation of the gravity waves reaching mesospheric heights. This is another experimental evidence that this is the ionospheric plasma densities, different frequencies, 2.8 megahertz, 2.5 megahertz, from 2 to about 6 megahertz. Different color codes are representing different frequencies, and their height of reflection undergoes this kind of a periodic variations. So these are clear indications of wave-like structures in the ionosphere, measured at the Ionospheric Observatory in Spain. And this again is attributed to the gravity waves propagating from the lower atmosphere and reaching up to ionospheric heights. And this is a two-dimensional picture using the parameter total electron content measured by GPS satellites, and measurement over a large number of points in this area, in the say European sector. So you see alternate red, yellow, blue, green, etc. color codes. That means maxima and minima in the TEC value, which again indicates the propagation of these waves. Now, another source of these gravity waves, we said, is the convective or thunderstorm activity. which occurs in the lower atmosphere within the troposphere, and then the gray color here are the presence of such convective structures measured by a particular type of radar. So meteorological radar, the refractivity maps are measure of the gray region here, measure of the thunderstorm or convective activity, and so that generates gravity waves which will reach up to ionospheric height, and these are the ionospheric parameters recorded using the parameter of total electron content. And you see here also color coded red and blue and green. So the reds indicate maxima, and blue or light green indicate minima. So there are maxima and minima, maxima and minima in a spatially propagating waves. So all these appear to propagate from the sort of source point here indicated by the arrow, which is the active region of this thunder clouds. So so there are concentric with respect to this point. So they are spatially propagating and reaching higher heights. So this is an evidence of that. Similarly, other evidence from based on the airglow imaging taken at higher heights in the thermosphere, and similarly the TEC maps. So they are having similar band-like structures, which is can be correlated with this. And so the structures have certain spatial wavelengths. So if you compare the depletion distance or something like the, say this is an enhancement, this is a depletion, this is an enhancement. So the distance between two depletions is a measure of the wavelength of the phenomena here, and the wavelength of the corresponding gravity waves is plotted here. So there is a good correlation between these two, which indicates that most probably these structures in the thermosphere and ionosphere are due to the gravity waves produced in the lower atmosphere and propagating up to those heights. So gravity waves can also propagate up to higher heights, ionospheric heights, produce traveling ionospheric disturbance, which in turn can create some sort of plasma irregularities or small scale structures which cause disruption of radio communication. So some plasma instability mechanism is triggered by these TIDs, and so they are believed to host field aligned irregularities of various scale sizes, giving spread up. We talked about equatorial spread up earlier, but in middle latitudes the reason for spread up is due to this kind of gravity waves and TIDs, which in turn cause the plasma irregularities. So this is all about waves. Now we talk about how the tides are affecting. We know that the sun heats up the atmosphere by absorbing its radiation, so atmosphere gets a bulge, and this is similar to the tides that we have in the ocean due to the gravitational pull of the moon, by which the sea level rises and falls at intervals of about 15 days. So that is a gravitational tide induced by the moon. Moon is very near, so gravitational effects can happen. Whereas these are the thermal tides induced by the solar heating. So a typical diurnal curve of the heating rate is like this, which is repeating day after day. So it's a sine, it's a periodic function, but not sinusoidal. So, but it can have its sinusoidal components like a diurnal mode and a semi-diurnal mode and so on. So how they are excited is shown here. The different constituents in the atmosphere, like water vapor in the troposphere, it absorbs the solar radiation and heats up this region. The ozone absorbs ultraviolet and heats up the middle atmosphere, and the upper atmosphere, the O2 and N2, which is absorbing solar radiation, getting photoionization and photodissociation, and some excess energy after those processes used to heat up this region. So different heights range are contributed by different constituents. So this basically, this ozone drives semi-diurnal tide, whereas this can drive both diurnal as well as semi-diurnal tidal modes. Also sometimes a terdiurnal tide can be produced, that is the third harmonic, with a period of 8 days. Diurnal means 24 hour periodicity, semi-diurnal 12-hour, 12-diurnal is 1/3, that is 8-hour periodicity, but it is due to, if there are two waves which are beating each other, then you get the sum and difference frequencies. So therefore, these are something like that due to the beating of the diurnal and semi-diurnal modes. These are the tidal modes generated by the sun. In addition, the earth gets heated up and re-radiates, and this re-radiated energy also heats up the atmosphere. So re-radiated heating depends on longitude, and because it depends on the land mass, like ocean, forest area, land area, and so on. So it is fixed at specific longitudes, the heating rate. So in addition to the direct solar heating, this also can produce heating. This excites modes with semi-periodicities of tides that are referred to as non-migrating. So this is not rotating with respect to the motion of the earth, but it is fixed at fixed places on the earth, depending upon the land sea distribution, the vegetation, non-vegetation distribution, etc. So these two kinds of tides, migrating and non-migrating, can also produce effects. It's an interesting observation. This is the globe, and we talked about the equatorial anomaly. So this is the equatorial ionization anomaly region, which is about plus or minus 15 degrees north and south of the magnetic equator. Magnetic equator is at the middle here. So there we have some sort of a wave pattern which shows, these are the maxima 1, 2, 3, 4 on either side. So it's a four wave pattern, wave four structure in the equatorial ionization anomaly crust, that is the crust region, which is an average of 30 days, so that the shorter periodicities are washed out or averaged out. And this is taken from the UV flux measurements, which is a measure of the density, plasma density there, and from the satellite, because the satellite really can give such a global coverage. And these coincide with amplitude enhancements, tidal amplitude enhancements simulated by a global wind model. So the tidal amplitudes are given by the contour lines. So they are also reaching maxima at these points where the EUV flux is also maximum, which is a clear indication of the coupling between ionization and the tidal waves, which are propagating and reaching up to that height. The tides can also contribute to a phenomena called counter electrojet, equatorial counter electrojet. We have seen in the earlier talk what is equatorial electrojet, a strong band of current going in eastward direction over the equator. But occasionally this current can reverse and become westward, and then it will be called a counter electrojet. So what is causing this? Some change in the wind pattern which drives the electrojet is required. So here the plot shows, and the dots are the occurrence of counter electrojets at different longitudes from 180 degree west to 190 degrees, covering the complete globe. And these slant bands are the phases of the tidal propagating modes. So we see that most of the dots are crowded or are accumulated at certain, say the white bands here, which indicate that that particular phase is favoring the occurrence of the counter electrojet. So therefore, the slanting lines indicate zero wind line of non-migrating tidal mode, referred to as DE3, diurnal eastward propagating wave number 3 tide. It may be seen that the red dots accumulate during the phase of DE3 tides, represented by the white shade, a particular phase. So CEJs are prevalent or more frequent in particular phase of the DE3 tide. This is the inference from this observation. So this is all about the role of waves and tides. In addition, there are also other waves which we cannot go into detail, like the equatorial trapped Kelvin waves, planetary waves, and Rossby waves, the different periodicities, and driven by different mechanisms. They too contribute in coupling processes from lower atmosphere to the higher heights. Now, another effect of the third diurnal tide that we talked about is what is called the midnight temperature maximum. So, here the ion temperature, the ionosphere has ions, electrons and neutrals, and we said in a plasma these temperatures are not the same. So, the ion temperature is plotted here. This is one day, this is another day, this is the midnight between these 2 days. So, normally one would expect temperature to decrease up to a minimum and then again repeat the cycle next day. But here at midnight, there is a, instead of decrease, there is an increase like this of the temperature, and this is marked by the arrow here, and that is what is called the midnight temperature maximum. The amplitude of this increase can be from 50 to about 200 Kelvin, and this occurs in equatorial and low latitudes. And this is from an observation by Martinez, recent in 2013, but the observation is taken in 1990, but paper is published in 2013. So it was first discovered in 1973 by the measurements of ionospheric temperature or plasma temperature by the incoherent scatter technique, which we discussed earlier. So it is now believed to be driven by third diurnal tide, that is with periodicity of 8 hours, propagating upward from lower atmosphere and interacting with a diurnally varying ion drag. There is a drag on the ions by the neutrals because of the collision between them. And these two forces are, the tidal force and the drag force are interacting, and they are causing this temperature maximum. This is the present inference or present thinking. Now, there is also a horizontal coupling, as we said, as indicated by this yellow arrow, from polar reach to lower latitude, mainly because of the dynamics and the wind system generated there by energy input from magnetosphere, then the magnetic field associated with that, the electric fields generated in that process. So that is the main emphasis here, the horizontal coupling from high latitude to low latitude. So with the result that some of the phenomena occurring at polar or auroral regions, they will show their effects in the equatorial atmosphere. So here we show a phenomena what is called magnetic storm, and the cause of that is illustrated here. This is the sun, and occasionally there is a phenomena called coronal mass ejection. That means a large chunk of coronal mass, coronal plasma, is ejected out into the space, and then it can travel in the interplanetary space to different planets. So it can reach Earth, it can travel in beyond the Earth and to other planets. So these coronal mass ejections, they are typically 10 to the power of 9 to 10 to the power of 10 tons in mass, and they also carry the solar magnetic field associated with that, and they travel with a typical speed of about 1000 kilometers per second. The normal solar wind velocity we said is about 400-450 kilometers per second, whereas the CME is traveling much faster. So they take their own time to reach the distance of one astronomical unit from sun to Earth, maybe of the order of a day or more. So once this occurs on the sun, after a delay of that much, 1 or 2 days, you will get its effect because of its impinging on the magnetospheric boundary. Some changes in the Earth's magnetic field will be felt, and that is what is shown here, that the magnetic field undergoes some deviations. So this initially there is a positive deviation, and then there is a very large negative deviation. Then again it recovers, and sometimes if another storm or another CME occurs, so you will see again a effect of that again. So it's a two storms occurring one after the other. The CME emission is pictured here. So the corona of the sun is masked by an instrument called coronagraph, and so that the bright light from the photosphere etc. are not coming, and then you can see these white flashes. They are the, just like a flash, the emissions, ejections from the sun. So these have their own effects on the Earth's magnetic field. The effect that they cause is the geomagnetic storm, in which when the coronal mass ejections or high speed solar wind streams hit magnetosphere, day side reconnection occurs. When the magnetic field in the CME plasma and the Earth's magnetic field, if they are in opposite direction, then they will cancel each other or annihilate each other. That is called reconnection. Then the magnetic energy is converted to plasma energy. So the plasma can energize. So occurs near the magnetopause boundary, that is on the day side, which results in the energization and enhancement of the particle population within the magnetosphere. So more particle population is created within the magnetosphere. That is what is shown with this. This was only this much. Now it is extended maximum particle population. Then it starts recovering. So this is what is shown here. Then this takes a few days, this process. So these produce geomagnetic storms. So this is all due to this process of energization of the magnetospheric particles, which is triggered by the CME. The initiation of the storm is, as I said, by the southward turning of the interplanetary magnetic field. We said the Earth's magnetic field is northward, so the interplanetary magnetic field is southward, then they cancel each other, and that starts the process of the storm, and the whole process starts lasts for a few days. There is another process called substorm, which occurs on the night side or the tail side of the magnetosphere. So here it is shown, the night side, these two field lines are having opposite polarity. So they can, if they touch here, the neutral line, a distant neutral line is produced. Again, if they another opposing occurs here, a near neutral line is produced. So then the plasma here, it gets detached from this and it becomes a plasmoid, and then it can drift freely under the influence of the electric field or other forces there. So the substorm occurs, it has a growth phase, this is the process in the expansion phase, and then finally it recovers, and this part again gets detached and it comes back to the normal magnetospheric configuration. This is also illustrated in a different way here. This is the solar wind particles by the full dots, and so and they are aligned along the magnetic interplanetary magnetic field, which is in opposite direction to the Earth's magnetic field. So annihilation takes place here. So the field line which should have normally closed, it is broken here and it is turned to either side. Then because of the solar wind pressure, it is pushed to the night side. Then it comes closer here, again reconnect. This is night side reconnection, which triggers the tail side reconnection, which triggers the substorm. Then the magnetic field and the solar plasma moves away. So they do this kind of things near the Earth, and then they further pass on to beyond the to end of the solar system. So then the plasmaspheric or magnetospheric particles, they drift inward, and then they come and impinge on the night side, and then they cause aurora and other phenomena there. So this is the complete cycle of the processes taking place there, and this energy can also drive magnetospheric convection, and that convection can generate a sort of magnetospheric electric field. So all these phenomena are interesting. What is this? Okay. So as I said, because of magnetospheric convection or interaction between the solar wind and the magnetosphere, some electric fields are generated, and so some kind of electric fields quickly penetrate from the high latitude. All these are generated in the high latitude region. From there, they immediately penetrate down to low latitudes. That is a way of coupling between high latitude and low latitude. So there are two kinds of fields: convection or under shielding electric fields generated by magnetospheric convection. And there are over shielding electric fields, which are due to the increase in the particle population in the inner magnetosphere. So these electric fields are superposed on the already existing dynamo generated ionospheric electric fields. So the combination of these. Excuse me, 1 minute. Okay. Thank you. Sorry for the interruption. These magnetospheric fields, which are penetrating to lower latitudes, they are superposed on the already existing ionospheric dynamo fields. And so interaction between these two fields will decide the net dynamics of the plasma. So the these fields generated the magnetospheric convection or overshielding. They are under shielding field is like this, or convection electric field from dawn to dusk, whereas the overshielding electric field is in the opposite direction. So that is why they have different effects on the ionosphere. One has positive effect, other has a negative effect like that. So this for the penetration during the main storm phase, the interplanetary electric field produced in the interaction between solar wind and magnetosphere that penetrates. Similarly, here in the nightshade reconnection often becomes stronger, and their influence is felt opposite to the under shielding electric field. This is the over shielding electric field due to the convection electric field penetrating, and this is the under shielding electric field. So these different electrics have their different effects. Now the geomagnetic disturbance or geomagnetic storm causes its associated effects in the ionosphere also through this process. So the geomagnetic disturbance creates a disturbance winds, the energy input in the high latitudes, particularly in the auroral zone due to UV heating and all. They change the wind system and create a new kind of wind circulation or thermospheric circulation, which is due to the additional energy input during the disturbance process. So changes in neutral wind will take place. Sometimes the gravity waves and that kind of propagating waves are generated, which carry the energy from high latitudes to lower regions. And then the altered disturbance winds change the ionospheric dynamo and the associated electric fields. So we get what is called disturbance dynamo electric fields. This is all due to the energy input at high latitudes changing the wind system there, which is traveling towards the lower latitudes, which is changing the dynamo there and creating a new kind of disturbance dynamo electric field. Then it can also generate the thermospheric winds can also change the temperature because of the heat conduction from high latitudes. So all this leads to generation of ionospheric storms, which have both positive and negative phase. So the disturbance dynamo effect field usually has an effect opposite to the normal ionospheric dynamo, which is illustrated here. So during the course of the day, we said the geomagnetic field increases like this. So one day it was increasing. So another day there was a disturbance dynamo electric field effect that reduced the diurnal increase of the magnetic field. So this is the reduction of electrojet due to disturbed dynamo effect after the substorm, which is result of which is superposed on the superposed analysis technique has derived this. So the altered winds is disturbed periods are nearly opposite to the usual thermospheric winds in quiet times. Therefore, they alter the ionospheric dynamo, varying the directionality and strength of the electric field generated. Sometimes if the field is so much opposite, it is turning to from eastward to westward, then at that time this kind of thing, counter electrojet can also be produced. So that is the disturbed dynamo electric field are altering the nature of zonal electric field, and there is no superposition as in the case of penetration field are or under shielding fields are eastward, so they add to the ionospheric field, whereas disturbance dynamo field is westward or opposite to ionospheric field, and therefore they try to cancel or weaken And so ionospheric storms are in general very large increase or decrease in ionospheric density. Correspondingly, they are known as positive or negative storms. So such severe storms can cause serious problems for satellite communication and navigation. Therefore, it is important to study and understand their mechanisms. Then negative storms can cause problems in ground-based radio communication, because the ionospheric densities will be decreased and that will affect the frequencies which are reflected by the ionosphere. It is necessary to monitor them. And some typical examples of the positive and negative storms are shown here. So this is the signature of the geomagnetic storm, the magnetic field fluctuation, we call disturbance, magnetic field during storm time. So it remains, this is before the disturbance. Actually, the storm starts somewhere at this time, then the magnetic field decreases much below the normal value, and then slowly it recovers. So this is the typical storm. Magnetic field decreases much below the storm normal value, then it decreases. The whole process lasts 2 or 3 days. So here the ionospheric density Nmax is shown as a function of time. This is 1 day, another day, another day. During this day, the black curve indicates the normal average value. This is the value on the given storm day, which is much higher than the average value. So this is what is positive storm. The electron density increases much above the average value as a result of the storm. So similarly here, there are different mechanisms for positive storm. Then eastward electric field or upward E cross B drift that will lift the ionization to a higher height, and thereby the ionospheric loss will be reduced, and so ionospheric densities can increase. In other words, upward E cross B drift, it alone cannot do, but it associated with a suitable neutral wind pattern can cause the positive storm over a narrow belt of latitudes like that. Similarly, the upward and downward motion of the thermosphere can change the composition of the atomic to molecular species, and that can also contribute. If atomic oxygen increases, electron density will increase. So if nitrogen increases, it will decrease. So like that, the ratio is sensitive to the occurrence of storm. This is the negative storm, where this is the again storm pattern, but the blue curve, which is the value on the storm day, is much less than the black curve, which is for the average value. So plasma densities are decreased, so therefore it's called negative phase. They are also caused by mainly chemical loss is enhanced, so the density decreases. Then the O over N2 ratio changes with enhancement of N2. That is what leads to loss of ionization by the recombination process. So the loss processes are faster, so the net plasma density decreases. That is, similarly, an increase in the thermospheric temperature can change the reaction rates, and that also can contribute to the negative storms. I think this will give a overall picture of the various effects driven by energy coming from the sun and upper regions, and then dynamical processes, waves, etc., generated at lower latitudes and propagating to ionosphere. So ionosphere is such a coupled and complex system which has interaction with many other regions in the near Earth space system. So we conclude the presentation here. So in this presentation, materials from scientific research papers, books and websites have been used. I am thankful to all the others for permitting to use their material. I give a sincere thanks to all the participants for their patient hearing. I hope that some additional or new knowledge has been gained by the participants by going through this series of 4 lectures in the webinar on the upper atmosphere. Thank you all.